Perasaan saya sangat bersyukur atas pelantikan ini kerana ini adalah merupakan rezeki ya daripada Allah Taala, dan saya juga rasa overwhelmed by the support that I have been getting so far. Alhamdulillah.
Menemu ramai beberapa orang bekas bos yang Mak Arif. Ada yang kata yang Mak Arif ini seorang yang sangat berdisiplin. Disiplinnya sampai 300%. Lepas tu, Tan Sri Zainul ya, sebab yang Arif pernah
betul.
Jadi SAR dia.
Betul.
Lepas tu, yang seorang lagi Datuk Sri Ahmad Aidil. Dia kata, macam first class graduate of the US je, yang nampak diam tapi sangat teliti dan actually very sharp. Seorang lagi Datuk Sri Bapa Sriram lah, dia kata,
well, he wasn't my boss in the sense that saya tak pernah jadi SAR dia.
Tapi dia kata Tan Sri Azmi Kamaluddin, the late Tan Sri Azmi Kamaluddin, masa dia High Court Judge, dia pernah menulis surat kepada yang Arif mengenai satu judgement yang Arif sebagai magistrate.
Yang Arif Tan Sri Azmi Kamaluddin ketika itu adalah Hakim Mahkamah Persekutuan.
Memang dia ada menulis.
Dia ada menulis surat kepada saya memberikan maklum balas tentang satu penghakiman yang saya tulis sebagai magistrate di Port Dickson. Menang Holdings. I can't remember the other party, but it was about summary judgment, and I wrote a one-page judgment. And his message to me was that it was a short and concise judgment, and that judgment should be a sample or model for the other magistrates to emulate. And his secretary told me that masa yang Arif Tan Sri Azmi membaca judgement itu, dia mempunyai banyak kes lain yang tak dibaca, dan bila baca judgement yang pendek itu dia rasa gembira kerana tidak perlu membuang banyak masa membaca judgement yang panjang-panjang untuk menghadapi rayuan, untuk menghadapi kes-kes yang bersifat rayuan daripada mahkamah bawah.
Dengan rekod-rekod lampau yang bagus
That is quite subjective.
Yeah. But coming from three very eminent people, especially Tan Sri Maimun herself, she praised you a lot in your work. So, but how are you going to instill this? As now you are the Chief Justice, how are you going to instill this kind of discipline and quality in your administration?
Well, it's quite difficult in the sense that I think this is something which is in you. But of course, we have to try and instill, as you were saying. And for the new appointments, we have these induction courses, this and that. The rationale for that is to expose them to the job scope and to instill in them the need to be efficient, the need to be hardworking, and to emphasize on them the qualities, what are the qualities to make them a good judge. So I think over time, people can acquire these skills. So hopefully, yes, they can be disciplined. This is something which can be acquired, I personally believe.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, next.
Perancangan itu untuk buat waktu ini agak sukar untuk saya nyatakan oleh kerana dua sebab. Pertamanya, saya perlu settle down. It's terlalu awal untuk saya menyatakan apa perancangan saya. Yang keduanya, kerana saya ingin mengamalkan apa yang telah dilaksanakan oleh mantan Ketua Hakim Negara iaitu Tan Sri Richard, di mana keempat-empat kami ini akan membuat keputusan secara kolektif leadership. Jadi sebelum saya menyatakan apa-apa perancangan, tentulah saya perlu dahulu ya, duduk dan berbincang bersama Yang Ma'arif, Yang Ma'arif yang tiga lagi.
Adakah Yang Ma'arif rasa tekanan sebagai muhakim wanita yang pertama tu jadi tekanan itu lebih sikit untuk
memikirkan? Secara jujurnya, saya tidak merasa tekanan itu dari segi saya sebagai seorang wanita. To me, gender is not a factor at all. Tetapi tekanan itu atas dasar jawatan itu, kerana tentu sekali jawatan itu menuntut satu adalah merupakan satu tanggungjawab yang besar. Jadi sama ada seorang wanita atau seorang lelaki memegang jawatan ini, sama sahaja pada saya. Responsibility itu atau tanggungjawab itu harus dilaksanakan sebaik mungkin.
Bernama?
Betul ke saya second termuda? Apapun, masih pada saya it's not really an issue lah, ya, sama ada termuda ke apa ke. Sebagaimana yang telah saya nyatakan tadi, overallnya ini suatu rezeki, alhamdulillah. So that's it, whether umur dan sebagainya itu tidaklah menjadi suatu yang pokok. Saya tidak fikir, rasanya taklah banyak mana dissenting judgement saya. Dan saya tidak fikir kriteria memberi dissenting judgement itu suatu kriteria yang perlu. Sebab untuk dilantik sebagai hakim ataupun untuk dinaikkan pangkat, dia kriterianya adalah banyak. Ya, tentu sekali lah apa nama ni, independence, kebolehan untuk memutuskan secara apa nama nak kata, cuma berdasarkan keterangan dan fakta yang ada di hadapannya tanpa mengambil kira faktor-faktor lain, itu penting, integriti, ya, dan tentu sekali competent and having a fair good knowledge of the law, ya. Jadi soal menulis dissenting judgement pada saya bukanlah, kalau kebetulannya kita perlu, and it's not always to me, it's not always that you have to dissent. Kalau perlu kepada satu penghakiman yang penghakiman yang sebulat suara, tidaklah bermaksudnya itu suatu yang tidak baik. Ya, so kita tak boleh nak membuat penilaian berdasarkan sama ada seseorang hakim tu pernah atau banyak membuat penghakiman menentang. Itu bukan kriterianya. Kalau secara kebetulannya seorang hakim tu perlu menulis penghakiman menentang, itu secara sendirinya tidak menjadikan dia lebih baik daripada hakim yang tidak pernah menulis penghakiman menentang. Mungkin kerana kes-kes yang telah diputuskan itu sewajarnya boleh dapat diputuskan secara penghakiman sebulat suara. Penghakiman yang mana? Yang mana? By the federal court. Ya. Yeah. Sejujurnya saya rasa bukan saya sendiri, bukan saya seorang saja. Saya percaya ramai hakim apabila kita telah mendengar kes dan kita telah membuat keputusan, kita sebenarnya tidaklah berapa concern ataupun gusar tentang sama ada penghakiman kita itu akan disahkan atau akan diakaskan oleh mahkamah atasan. Sebab pada kita telah membuat, telah melaksanakan tanggungjawab kita. Jika kebetulannya keputusan kita itu disahkan, bermaksudnya mahkamah atasan bersetuju dengan pemahaman kita dan pendirian kita dengan prinsip undang-undang, itu sahaja. So maksud kata secara kesimpulannya, tidaklah bermakna kalau keputusan sesuatu hakim itu disahkan oleh mahkamah atasan, judge should be particularly overjoyed. Ya, itu cuma satu proses yang biasa.
Yang mari, can I tanya a personal question? I mean, in the sense that
Yes.
Then,
right.
Being a better part, Chief Justice. So, how do you feel by passing the lot of your senior brother and sister judges
Well, pertama sekalinya ini bukan suatu jawatan yang dipohon. Ya, ini adalah rezeki ketentuan Allah SWT. Jadi saya percaya walaupun saya junior, saya percaya senior-senior yang saya langkau tidak mempunyai perasaan kurang senang sebab semuanya sebagai terutama sekali as Muslims we believe that this is something which you know if it, ketentuan Allah, if it's meant to be for us, it will be for us. At this point, what I can say is that apa-apa reform yang telah dimulakan oleh Tan Sri Richard Malanjum, kita akan teruskan. Kita akan teruskan dan yang selebihnya, mana yang masih di peringkat infancy, for example, dan kita akan mulakanlah ataupun baik, menambah baik dan sebagainya. Apa yang belum, kalau nak disebutkan perkara-perkara yang baru, itu yang saya katakan tadi, saya perlu duduk bersama yang makrif-makrif yang lain sebelum saya dapat memutuskan apakah bidang atau area mana yang perlu dibuat pembaharuan. But I believe as of now, banyak lagi perkara-perkara yang telah dimulakan oleh Tan Sri Richard yang perlu kita teruskan, ya. Bukan, saya tidak rasa itu new criteria. Dari masa ke semasa sebagai hakim-hakim, kita sering mendapat guidance daripada Ketua Hakim Negara juga. Dan saya masih ingat ketika saya di Mahkamah Rayuan juga, Presiden Mahkamah Rayuan ketika itu juga memberikan pandangannya bahawa tidaklah perlu untuk setiap kes kita menulis alasan-alasan yang panjang. Jadi itu bukan new criteria. New challenges, main challenges. What I can foresee, well, maybe to maintain the public confidence of judiciary, and the other one probably to manage the negative perception of the public. I think that question would have been answered by the earlier. Jawapan saya samalah dengan soalan-soalan yang telah dikemukakan terdahulu tentang reform. Thank you.
I would like to ask a slightly critical question if I may. When you mentioned public perception and negative perception. We all know it's been in the fray for quite a while, especially against the backdrop of the damning affidavit by Justice Bakir. So I would like to know, do you think your job in reforming the judiciary would be more challenging in the face of that affidavit?
Well, in terms of perception, it would be, but in real terms, it is not so. You see, it's a matter of perception. So, in real terms, it's not going to be any challenging because apa yang berlaku itu sebenarnya bukan fakta. It's perception.
But what do you think caused such negative perceptions to?
Well, if I can answer you honestly, social media is one of the reasons. Because sometimes people write in the social media things which they do not have the actual knowledge of. And this will go viral.
So what do you think is required to address this negative perception? A greater understanding of the social media? Or what, in your opinion, what do you think would be best?
The media should probably play a role, especially the mainstream media, to report cases, accurately, and in terms of public interest cases or important cases, what we do have now is to prepare press summary for the press. So we will do that. The reason behind that is when we issue that press summary of the judgments, then it's easier to understand rather than the whole judgment being given to the press. So it would be easier, and that means you all have a responsibility to report it accurately.
I would like to ask about another allegation. There have been allegations of abuse of power occurred towards the past CJs in recommending the transfer of judges, especially when judges from lower courts do not supposedly follow orders. I heard you were one of those who received such orders when, in doing your judgments and whatnot. How do you address this issue now since you are the CJ?
Well, what you heard is not true, first. Second, why do we need to go back to the things which had happened in the past? I think we should move on, if at all there was any truth in it. But I must say that what you heard about me getting that order was not true. And if I may say this, the transfer of judges, especially in the lower courts, is not in the domain, or it's not actually the job scope of the Chief Justice. The matter of transfer, especially amongst the officers in the lower court, or judges, sessions judges, magistrates, that is a matter between the Chief Registrar, after consultation with the Chief Judge of Malaya, or the Chief Judge of Sabah and Sarawak. So the CJ has nothing to do with the transfer of officers, because I was a Chief Registrar before. I never had to go and deal with the Chief Justice in terms of transfer of officers. No. So that definitely is not a correct position, what you were saying.
I would like to ask about disparities. There has also been public perception of ethnic, religious, gender and regional disparities. There is a perception that the judiciary has these disparities. Do you feel this is a fair view? And do you agree with the view? And if you do, how do you address them? And if you don't, then how do you address the perception of them?
I don't agree. That is not a fair view at all. And if I may say, just the recent appointment of the JCs, about a few days ago, I think we managed to get the candidates or the appointments from diverse background. So if we're talking about disparity, we don't see that in the last appointment of the JCs.
If I may ask the last question and I'll be done with it. Do you think the judiciary is now up to standard in terms of concluding cases in time? I think previously, I can't remember which CJ exactly, he had a KPI set for this kind of thing. Have we come to a stage where we can be proud of the improvements in that arena, or do you think there can be more reforms in this particular area?
I think we have that report by the World Bank on this timeline, and we're saying KPI where we don't like to mention to use the word KPI. It's a benchmark, for the timeline for the disposal of cases. I think we have achieved that target, and we should be proud, because maybe more than 90% of the cases we were able to meet that timeline. And of course, without compromising on the justice of the case and the quality of the judgments. But of course, I'm sorry, of course we cannot achieve 100%, because not all cases are, simple cases. Some are more complex than the others. So, but basically, I think we have achieved whatever targets that we were saying. And we should be proud of ourselves, because even the World Bank had written a good report on us in that area.
So can we say that's probably a culture of less lenient adjournment, if that's right for me to say it that way? Because adjournments sometimes tend to prolong the timeline of certain cases. So can we say that's lesser currently?
No, I think that we have always taken the consistent stand on adjournment. that once a case has been fixed, there shouldn't be any adjournment, unless, of course, you know, some real emergency crops up. But just because a lawyer is engaged elsewhere, for example, that is not a good reason for adjournment. Unless he is sick, you know, unless something really, some really emergency matters crop up. So in terms of adjournment, I can't say that we can be lenient now. The position has always been the same. Adjournment is not to be granted, you know, freely. We should be strict because, you see, once cases have been fixed, witnesses come to court. Litigants come. We don't know from where, from far maybe, from near, but that will cause inconvenience to the public if last-minute adjournment is granted. So the position will remain the same.
Thank you.
Tiada.
Dan kenapa memilih bidang perundangan daripada bidang lain?
Saya tak boleh jawab sebab sebenarnya saya tak pilih. Okay. Secara consciousnya, it so happen that, you know, begitulah ketentuan Allah Ta'ala lah. Yeah? Bukan secara consciousnya pilih bidang ini. You know, semasa kita lepas form 6, when we want to apply for whatever courses, nak masuk universiti, sometimes bukan kita faham dan fikir sangat apakah kos mana yang kita nak pohon dan sebagainya. So, you know, it's secara ini semua pun saya fikir ketentuan Allah Ta'ala. Yeah. Anything else? Sorry? Oh, on the RCI. Well, the government has already decided to set up the RCI. Our position is this. What would happen next, we will have to wait. What would be the next step to be taken by the government? Because it is in the government's hand. Pada kes yang berprofil tinggi itu, apa yang nampaknya berbeza itu pada saya cumalah pandangan masyarakat. Ya? Dari sudut mahkamah sama saja. Kita baru saja tambah berkuat kuasa hari ini satu mahkamah jenayah di Kuala Lumpur. Judicial Appointment Commission.
So how would you handle this scenario?
To To be fair, I don't think I'm in position to answer sebab saya belum pernah lagi duduk di dalam JAK, ya. Yeah? Jadi macam mana mereka menilai apakah kriteria, jadi saya tak boleh pada peringkat ini memberi komen. To me, a good judge will be a judge who would always be reminded of his oath of office and always be reminded of the code of conduct as stipulated in the judge's code of ethics. Yeah, and of course, the other basic principles as stipulated in the bungalow law principles and all those other criteria or qualities that, giving the parties before you the right to be heard, being courteous to everyone that is in the court. If you need to tegur any of the peguam or pihak-pihak, then do it courteously. So be fair to everybody. Treat the lawyers, juniors or seniors alike. And of course, be efficient. When I say efficient, what I mean is that if there is a timeline, then you adhere to the timeline, but of course never to compromise the quality of your work. I think my message would be just work hard, be honest and work hard. Unfortunately, no.
You do not watch any.
No, we actually, I think we judges, we don't have time to watch TV. not much time to watch TV. Not much time to do anything else but read the records, write grounds. You know, we work late in the middle of the night. We work in the wee hours of the morning. We work on weekends. So there is really not much time to watch television or movies.
I was hoping you were probably a Game of Thrones.
Okay, is that all?
How do you balance your work and personal life? Because you're also a mother and grandmother, right?
Right. For that, I have to thank my husband, especially, and my children. And I am blessed in the sense that I've got a very understanding husband. In fact, when I was first elevated to the High Court, he reminded me that being a judge is a great honor. And in his words, he said, a judge's legacy is his judgments. And so he reminded me that as a judge, I must write judgments. And in terms of the other domestic chores, I am so blessed because I have my cousin who lives with me for the past 30 years, and she has been assisting me in terms of my domestic chores and helping me raising the children. So I'm really blessed in that sense. And I think that is probably one of the reasons why I could, concentrate on my work, because when I need to do work, then my husband will understand, because it was his encouragement and he advised that I should be working hard, I should be writing grounds, and the children, they also understand. No, unfortunately, I have nothing exciting or interesting to share because I wasn't very clever and I was not naughty either. Yeah? So, tak ada apa-apa yang nak dikongsi lah. But if I may take this opportunity, sempena perayaan Hari Guru, I wish to say a big thank you to all the teachers that have taught me in Kota Baru, in Seremban, and also to all my lecturers who taught me in the Law Faculty Universiti Melaya. Saya mengambil kesempatan ini untuk menjunjung setinggi-tinggi kasih kepada Duli Yang Maha Mulia Seri Paduka Baginda dan Pertuan Agong atas perkenan Baginda melantik saya sebagai Ketua Hakim Negara yang baru. Dan pada kesempatan ini saya juga ingin merakamkan setinggi-tinggi penghargaan dan terima kasih kepada Yang Amat Bahagia Tan Sri Richard Malanjum yang telah memberikan khidmat bakti kepada Badan Kehakiman.
Okay, that's all. Thank you. We will proceed for photo shoot dekat sebelah. So, we will usher.